So here's a question for you. Why do you think God decided to create the world? What motivated God to create light, day and night, to make the mountains rise and to build the lofty skies? What inspired God to fashion plants and animals, human beings, you and me? I'm not talking about the how of it, not suggesting we debate this morning the Big Bang Theory or evolution, but rather just for a few moments to ponder the why. Why did God create the world? I mean, God was being God, and then for some reason, something, the power to create, the desire to create, the need to create became so overwhelming, so formidable, that it just demanded to be expressed. And so then God started to create. And it was good. That's sort of astonishing just to think about, that God decided to create and then create and then create, and it was just so very good. So possibly equally astonishing is that then God made the choice to entrust all that was created to you and me. God entrusted creation into our care. God gave to all of us the gift of creation. That's really sort of astonishing, because think of all the energy that was involved in creation. Think of all the choices that were made as God was creating all of the world. I mean, God could have chosen to use just one color, but instead God chose to use a huge array of color. And we have green grass and blue skies and orange and yellow sunsets. In places like New England, God created four seasons distinct that we get to enjoy every single year. Now, it's true, every once in a while, we might question some of the choices God made during creation. Tricia Herrick and I had decided that we were going to print up some t-shirts for ourselves, because while we were in North Carolina, we confronted the most gigantic cockroach in the world. So we were going to create t-shirts that said, "I survived the cockroach attack in 2016. I mean, it was this big, right? Maybe it was close to this big. But you know, then you wonder, like, really, God, do we have to have cockroaches? And yet, of course, we know they have their function. They serve as food for birds and other animals, and I bet they have something to do with keeping our forests healthy. So there is something incredible, astonishing, about the intricate interconnectedness of all that God made. It is truly astonishing to consider all that God created and then entrusted that into our care. And then, as God fashioned humanity, God chose to instill within each one of us that power to create. Each one of us has within us a portion of that power of creativity, and it urges us to be expressed at some point. So similar to whatever happened that God made the decision to start to create the whole world, there are those moments in our lives when that power to create urges us to give that creativity expression. Sometimes it's described as a certain kind of restlessness, or people are even uncomfortable until they give their creativity expression. In that passage from Philippians, Paul talks about the persistence that faith has, asking it to be expressed. And in a similar way, there's something about creativity and its persistence. It won't stay still. It urges to be uncorked and to be expressed fully. In October of 2014, the National Public Radio host Scott Simon interviewed Gillian Lynn. Gillian Lynn is someone who had a highly successful career as a dancer. career began with the Royal Ballet Company in London, and she performed as a soloist all around the world. Later, when that part of her career ended, she then established her own musical theater company and produced many successful shows in both London and in New York. And then she met Andrew Lloyd Webber, and she was highly instrumental in the production of some of the most successful theater music productions of all time, like Cats and Phantom of the Opera. But when she was younger, about 7 or 8 years old, and that was in the 30s, her future looked anything but bright. Her parents received a letter from her school detailing all the ways that Gillian was not being successful in school. She was not testing well. Her handwriting was very bad. She very often did not turn in her homework assignments, and she was disturbing the other children. Her nickname at school was Ribblebottom. Well, when her parents received this letter, they were immediately distressed, and so they took Gillian to a psychologist for evaluation. And as the psychologist was interviewing her mother, Gillian sat on her hands, hoping that maybe that would help her stop moving so much. She didn't really understand what was going on, but she knew that somehow she was in trouble for the way she moved all the time. And she felt like while the psychologist was talking to her mother, he kept looking at her. And so after a while, the psychologist looked at Gillian herself and said, "Thank you so much for being patient while I've been interviewing your mom, but I need to talk to her for a little bit on her own, and so we're going to leave for a few moments." And as they walked out, the psychologist turned on his radio to a music station. And then Mrs. Lynn and the psychologist watched through a window as almost immediately Gillian stood up and she began to move to that music with grace and beauty. And the psychologist said, "This diagnosis is easy. Your daughter has the ability to dance. She has within her the creative ability to dance, and it is restless and uncomfortable for her that she has not been able to express that. There's something within us that we have a creative energy, a talent. What we need to do is express that." Now, the book that Lisa read by Tommy DePaolo is autobiographical in many ways. It is called The Art Lesson. And in an interview, DePaolo said that by the time he was 4 years old, he knew what he wanted to do when he grew up. He wanted to draw, he wanted to write, he wanted to sing, and he wanted to tap dance. Now, at the age of 81, living in London, New Hampshire, DePaolo has accomplished all of his goals. But the one that he is most known for are the 250 books that he has written, illustrated, or written and illustrated. And in a speech he gave when he was receiving the Regina Medal from the Catholic Library Association, he talked about the influence being raised Catholic had on him and on his artwork, because he said it really was highly influential to him to be raised in Catholic churches that had so much artwork and to be around those cathedrals and in Catholic homes that were so much artwork. But there was a time when DePaolo's career or his future also looked bleak. He decided at one point that he wanted to enter into a monastery and become a monk, but that attempt did not go well. He failed at it. And as he left the monastery, he felt absolutely devastated, just considered himself a failure. He couldn't eat, he couldn't sleep, and he certainly couldn't draw. But it was in a conversation and a visit with a very good friend that he began to think that there might be hope for him and that there might be some direction. And this friend, Warren, said to him, "I want you to draw something for me." And he said, I just can't. And then she said, "Our art is both our work and our prayer. So you may not be able to be a saint by being a monk, but you can save your soul by drawing. And you might be able to save someone else at the same time." And now 40 years later, DePaolo is still drawing, still creating books. And he says it was because of his one word he wrote, or maybe one picture that he drew, might touch a child's heart and influence that child in some kind of positive way. Lynn and Apollo, they had within them a creative energy, a creative gift that just was restless and uncomfortable, and it demanded to be given expression. All of us here this morning have been given a gift of creativity, and we are urged to express that gift. The theologian Paul Scherer made an interesting comment about the gifts and about creativity. He said one time, gifts, what are they? But if we place our gifts in the hands of God, then that's true religion. Now that's definitely a circle, isn't it? God created the world, God gave us the gift of creativity, and when we place our gifts in the hands of God, the Spirit moves among us, moves among those in our lives. We can feel God's Spirit influencing us and all those around us. It's what I like so much about that passage in Exodus, which I did apologize to Lisa for. Did you hear how many names she had to try to pronounce as she read that? That's really mean to do with somebody. But in that passage, there are some discussion of builders and artisans, people who work with bronze and silver, and they lay their gifts in God's hands, and together they create a beautiful worship space. We all have been given gifts of creativity. We've seen that in Lisa's worship leadership today. We've seen it in the music that Esther makes and the music that Elon made for us this morning. And Vinny talking about his experience. But all of us have creative energy. Some of you are so creative in the kitchen. It's astounding what you can create there. And then people come together and they share lively conversation through that gift that you give. Some of you are so creative with knitting needles and crochet hooks. And you make prayer shawls or things that keep people warm, and your creativity is expressed. Some of you are so creative in your problem solving. You're creative in the way you handle financial difficulties. You're creative in the new ideas that you are able to express. God has granted to all of us the gift of creativity, and if we place those gifts, if we place our creative energy in God's hands, oh my gosh, the Spirit lives within us and in the people all around us. So why do you think God decided to create the world? We may never know, but what we do know is that God created the world, entrusted it to our hands, gave us the gift of creativity. And when we place our gifts in God's hands, God's Spirit, God's creativity is just, it's let loose in.